Welcome to Bethel Park School District Special Services Department Parent Guardian Night. I'm Lori Sutton, Director of Special Education. Each year, we offer a series of information sessions designed to provide an opportunity for training and information sharing for parents and guardians. Tonight's session is a focus on mental health supports and services in Bethel Park School District. A panel format will be presented with our interagency partners sharing a brief overview of how they contribute to our district and the students and families that we serve. We are pleased to have the opportunity to present this program to our audience here tonight, as well as to have a recording of it made by the Municipality of Bethel Park's Public Access Television. This program will also be linked on the district website with additional handouts and resources. My co-hosts this evening are Dr. Janet O'Rourke and Dr. Sarah Hsu. Dr. O'Rourke is the Assistant to the Superintendent for Evaluations, Human Resources, and Assessments. Janet will be concluding our evening with information and an invitation for you to attend the upcoming Bethel Park Wellness Summit. Dr. Hsu is our Assistant Director of Special Education, and Sarah will now lead us into the question answer segment of our presentation. Thank you all for being here this evening. Really glad to have you.
Hi everyone. We're gonna go quickly through the panel and have each panel member describe their role at Bethel Park in the community right now. If you could just state your name and explain your role, please.
Provided in the school setting throughout the school day so that the student isn't having to make appointments, and the parents aren't having to make appointments and juggle another thing outside of the school day. Then also, Auberle is providing SAP services, which is the Student Assistance Program, and that service is designed to help students who are having difficulty experiencing success in the school setting. It's a team of nurses, the psychologists, the social worker, to work together to come up with a strategy or a plan to help that student achieve some success. And that can look like referrals to school-based therapy or other outside providers. And we have a SAP liaison that helps kind of coordinate and work together between the school system and then the community resources as well.
Hi, my name is Trustee Hewitt. I work for Allegheny County Office of Behavioral Health, where I work as a school-based liaison. School-based liaison isn't a position that's available in most states or even most counties. What I do as a school-based liaison is I'm assigned to multiple different school districts or school systems. And I help the school districts build behavioral health programming within the school district or within the school building. We help mediate provider or school conflict if there's conflict with any type of behavioral health provider. We provide technical assistance to school districts. Staff members can ask us questions about accessing behavioral health services or accessing any other child system resource, and my job is to help the school figure out what's available for families or students within the district. I can work with families directly, so if a family has a child with a behavioral health concern or any other child system issue, they are able to come to me, and my job is to help that family get their child, get the family connected with any support or resource to help the situation out. And last, we are the administrators of the Student Assistance Program for Allegheny County. So we help providers with the Student Assistance Program. We help school districts make sure they have the student assistance resources needed for successful outcomes for students.
I'm Adam McDivitt from Southwood. I supervise the EPIC program, Education Prevention, Intervention, and Consultation. We run a very similar program to school-based where the kids are referred by teachers. We get permission from the parents just via a form that the child takes home and returns to the school. and they meet and they can receive therapy generally one time a week, but it can be more. We also provide groups, social skills, lunch bunches, which is just kind of a friendship group, and anything that the kids need that the teachers can refer. They can identify their students that might need a little assistance. If they seem to be struggling with anxiety, depression, and anything else that might be going on with an identified child.
Hello, my name is Jenica Schoolcraft. I'm the program manager at Outreach Teen and Family Services. So we recently have a partnership with Bethel Park District and the municipality where we are available to the students of Bethel Park and their families at no cost due to the contract that we have here at Bethel Park. So we often see students who are suffering from anxiety and depression. We can see them in school. We can see them at the municipality building every Monday from 3:30 to 6:30. We can take referrals, or the school counselors can refer students to us, or if the students are aware of our services, they can feel free to reach out to us as well. We do have a home location in Mount Lebanon, so they can either reach out or see us in the school in Mount Lebanon or in Bethel Park. So we do what we can to break down the barriers that might be preventing them from seeking the care that they need.
Summers. I'm a school psychologist, one of two in the district. Our role can vary from school to school, but we are, you know, there for to help identify at-risk students, to help develop interventions for them. We sometimes sit in on different intervention teams, SAP teams. We also conduct evaluations for our students who may be in need of additional supports and services. So we have various roles in the district, but we're in different areas as well. So.
I'm Megan Enoch, the other school psychologist. I work closely with Crystal, and I do a lot of the things that she just said. I service the students at the high school, the 5 and 6 Neil Armstrong building, and two of the elementaries, Abraham Lincoln and Memorial Elementary.
Okay, thank you all for that in detailed explanation of your background and your roles. At this point, we're gonna go through some panel questions that we've already pre-populated, and then we'll open it up to the floor for any additional questions that you guys may have. Our first question is, and feel free to answer wherever you feel that your expertise lie, what are the signs that a student may be struggling and or at home or school? What are some signs that a parent could look for or a teacher could look for that a student is struggling?
I think first, failing grades, a decrease in academics, avoidance of schoolwork. Another sign or symptom that we see often is truancy. We see kids just stop coming to school because they're experiencing stress surrounding school.
I think another thing we see too is students maybe losing interest in things that they once enjoyed doing, wanting to not participate in activities anymore, maybe a sudden group change of friend group, surrounding themselves with peers that might not be as a positive influence anymore.
I think in addition to that, also excessive sleeping more than usual, kind of goes along with the avoidance piece and just not feeling interested in their normal routine, their normal activities.
There's physical signs too, frequent stomach aches, or in particular, I think with my team, we see a lot of kids going to the nurse at particular times of the day to possibly avoid a particular class or to avoid a particular student. So you might see somebody going to the nurse frequently, you might see somebody going to guidance frequently. Those kinds of things can also be signs that there's a struggle.
Irritability, outbursts, changes in mood.
I'm going to add a question to what the panel would be added to that. When you start to see these signs for a parent or a teacher, what are some things that they can do to assist those students when they think perhaps there may be an issue with the student? They're seeing these signs, they're seeing increased truancy. The nurse is constantly calling home during a specific period of the day. What are some things that parents and or teachers can do?
Well, I'd say from the parent's perspective, reaching out to the teacher to see if there are, similar issues being seen at school, how that's, can be addressed at school, I think would be maybe the first step.
I think from a teacher's perspective, and I do want to say that I'm not a licensed therapist, I'm an MPA, but I do work with kids in my primary job. And I think for children who are showing signs of agitation or change in usual personality, oftentimes I feel that you can, from a teacher perspective, if you can approach the student when they're not around their group mates, when they're, or their classmates, not pulling them out in front of everyone, letting the class dismiss, and then kind of trailing behind, being like, hey, I noticed such and such, are you okay? And even if they say no at first, keep asking, because at one point that conversation is going to develop trust between those two, and they may come to you and say, yeah, actually there is something going on. Or even if it elicits an idea in their head that this adult cares, maybe I do go to my school counselor and ask for more help, or I can go to that a trusted adult that I respect that I can go to for help.
I know right now mental health is a big topic in the news, in our schools. What is approximately the prevalence of students struggling with mental health needs right now?
I think there's a significant amount of students struggling from mental health all over. I'm fortunate enough to be able to work with multiple school districts, and I think we see in multiple school districts a pattern where school staff members come to us and ask for supports and resources to help try to rectify a problem that they're experiencing. The problem is that they have a lot of students with significant behavioral health needs, or a lot of students with behavioral health needs, and there's not enough time in the school day to help them work through the different stresses that they're experiencing during school. So I think there's a high prevalence of students struggling with mental health within schools.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I'm starting to see, I feel like, a trend starting younger and younger kids are starting to come and have more mental health issues and be referred for mental health that I didn't see, and I've been doing this for 12 years and I haven't seen that in years past, so I definitely I'm starting to see more. There's definitely an incline in that respect.
Some studies suggest that students coming out of high school going into college, one out of every three shows significant clinical signs of depression and or anxiety. That is significant. That is a lot of students. And that's coming out of high school going into college.
That's actually a fantastic segue, because my next question is, what can we do currently with students elementary to high school with students, what can we do to support students with anxiety in the classroom?
First thing that I think of is communication with the teacher, because sometimes anxiety and depression is more of an internalizing emotion. fidgety. They might be avoiding any tasks, you know, fidgety, sweating. So I think communication with the teacher and the school staff is a good first step.
I think it's so important that also that there's a good relationship between teacher and student. I think that allows them to open up more to the teacher and kind of, be able to express themselves to the teacher. So I do think that that's an important part, having that good, strong relationship. Encouraging student-teacher connections, whether that's, saying hi to the students in the hallways, when they first come in the morning, giving them a high five, giving them a fist bump, just letting them know that, you're there for them, that if they need to talk with you, that you're there.
The fastest way to get improvement from a psychological standpoint is exactly what these ladies were talking about, and that's rapport. Whether it's parents building rapport with teachers or the teachers building rapport with their students, those things can form a symbiotic relationship that can really, really help children, particularly ones that are struggling. But parents have to know that it's happening in the school, and the teachers need to know that it's happening in the home, or then it just looks like anger if you're not communicating. And then that just is frustrating for everybody. So that rapport, that ability to talk is extremely, extremely important.
Once the symptoms are identified, coming up with a plan with the student, with strategies on how they can manage that anxiety within the classroom in the least disruptive way so that the teacher can keep teaching and the students can keep learning, is to come up with a effective but personalized plan for that student. And that could look like, taking a step out and going to the bathroom or getting a drink of water, or allowing them maybe 5 minutes to listen to their music, their headphones, until they're able to transition back to the classroom. Whatever it is that works for that student, but coming up with a solid plan for when they are struggling within the classroom, just so that they can stay within the classroom setting as much as possible rather than leaving for periods at a time.
Would that also be the same for parents? If a parent knows that a student is struggling with anxiety in school, they're starting to become avoidant, like you had spoken earlier, starting to see a little bit more truancy and irritability with anxiety and coming to school, what can a parent do on that side?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's really important at home to open up that communication and really figure out what is that student needing in those moments when they're really struggling the most, and helping that student even figure it out, because they might not know. They might not know that they need 5 minutes before they talk about what they're struggling with, or they might need to just talk about it in the moment and have that space, and just helping them figure that out and coming up with a plan in each setting.
And that's something that outreach can offer as well. We don't just see students, we see families and parents too. And so part of that is the parents knowing that we offer free parent consultation. So if a parent doesn't know, they can always call and ask for guidance as well. And that might even look like, asking your school counselors, what are they seeing? Asking teachers, what are they seeing in the classroom? And coming together and putting those facets together to further help you make a decision or help you navigate through the issue.
I was also going to say that I think it's important to ourselves as school staff members and teachers to model and demonstrate and help teach coping strategies with that anxiety, because they're going to have anxiety probably a really long time, and we want to help them provide the tools of how to manage that, whether that might be organizational skills. If they've missed a lot of school and it's all piling up, how can we help them to tackle it that it doesn't seem like a mountain to overcome? Or that might be some deep breathing practices just remembering that kind of stuff when you're in the heat of the moment and your anxiety is rising, and how can you keep that at bay to face whatever challenge that you might be having.
I think that's a good point about the modeling. I feel like a lot of times I've seen in the past with students who have anxiety, parents also might have anxiety or other issues too. And so sometimes it's the best thing that to show that you're also, you know, need help or are going and seeking out help, using those strategies, practicing those strategies in front of the student, and so that they could feel like that's okay for them to do it too. Sometimes, you know, family therapy and things like that can help. So, you know, those are all things to consider.
One of the things I try to talk to the social workers about that see our kids in the EPIC program is get the kids excited about their coping strategy so they go home and share that with their parents. To build that, you know, if they're like, hey, this really helps me, mom and dad, maybe that'll send a sign to them like, hey, we can maybe do this here. And trying to get those kinds of signs and that kind of help generalizable in all facets, and not just what works at the school, but what works for me as a student.
And I think good communicating with the school about the child's anxiety or the child's behavioral health concerns, and sharing what coping strategies work at home and what coping strategies work at school, and trying to get everybody together and on the same page and doing the same things to help manage the situation.
Is it also safe to say that we've got great resources that parents can always refer their children to the Students Assistance Program? They can reach out to any administration member, refer them to the EPIC team, outreach, or our school psychologist. We can all be wonderful resources to parents in that manner, in addition to the wonderful ideas that you suggested. Also, my next question is, how can staff members support students who have experienced trauma? And what does that look like in a classroom?
I think being self-aware that you yourself or the environment can be a trigger to a child who has experienced trauma. So anything from your hair color to your hairstyle to the perfume you wear, the cologne, or you know, the color of your shirt, those could all be subtle triggers that you're not aware of and the student may not be aware of, but just the fact that the student could be triggered by environmental factors could help them respond more effectively, just knowing that bit of information and just being sensitive to that.
I think being sensitive is a really key point, because we don't know if how they've experienced it or how they've reacted to trauma. There could be two siblings that experience the same trauma, but one may have a different reaction than the other. And knowing the appropriate intervention at the right time, because when you think about how, if you personally have reacted to a scary situation in your life, you have that fight, flight, or freeze feeling that it kind of, you know, gets you to pause up or run away, and you know, and students with trauma might have that feeling at all times, and it might not ever go away or decrease. So they're always having that feeling, and then knowing that if they are in that feeling, then they have trouble problem solving or de-escalating and figuring out what am I going to do, and they're not going to listen to redirection at that time. So if they're escalated, knowing that you need to calm them down first and get them to that safe space, and then you can talk through how you can intervene and help them.
I think empathetic listening is also important, which is not that easy to do sometimes, because as adults we want to fix it, we want to go in and solve the problem immediately. But sometimes just being listening and taking on what exactly they're saying or trying to convey to you, and then just being reflective in everything to help them to you know, gather their emotions and be able to express what they're trying to express, I think is important.
There's an industry buzzword that we use all the time, and that's trauma-informed care. And I think the key to that really, for just general people, is to just assume everybody has some kind of trauma, and then you're not overstepping to a point where you could be upsetting somebody. And that's a real basic without getting super technical, right? But I think one of the things that staff members can run into is the overhelp, and they want to get too involved. And I want to caution people to not get too involved and refer out. When it starts to get uncomfortable, find somebody else that'll help. Reach out to school-based, reach out to Epic. Go talk to your administrator, or call the school and say, hey, can we get this kid help? This is outside of my comfort zone. And I think knowing that is okay too. And being aware, like, at some point, I'm not the therapist, I'm the teacher. At some point, I'm not the therapist, I'm the parent. And saying, I need some extra help. And it's totally, totally okay to ask for extra help, especially when trauma is involved, because that means something significant, some significant event happened to this child, to this family, that they're reaching out for most likely in the first place.
I think of effective planning, understanding that a student has experienced trauma, and just formulating a plan so that individual, that student, can get to a safe place to help de-escalate and do it in the most discreet manner possible is very successful.
Thank you. Those were all amazing answers. My next question follows with something I'm sure you're all very familiar with. How can a parent or student access mental health or behavioral health services outside of school? And perhaps what process that they can go through to get there. I know each one of you has your own different route, so feel free to take your own spin on this question.
Right, so again, Outreach Teen is, it's available to any student in the Bethel Park District. Either a parent can reach out if you all feel like you need to come in as a family. A student on their own can reach out. As long as they're 14 years old, they receive confidential counseling aside from their parents. It's free. They can call our home office in Mount Lebanon and request a session then. Within 48 hours, typically, a counselor will get back to whomever is calling, be it a parent, guardian, or a student. Our school counselors have our information, as well as the administrative offices. So if they were timid to reach out on their own, then you know, I would say reach out to your administrators, your teachers, and your counselors, and we can get you the help that you need.
Can I follow up with a question on that?
Yes, ma'am.
I believe that outreach is available on Monday nights at the municipality building.
That's correct, yes.
If a student just showed up that night, or a family just showed up that night, said, I didn't call anybody, I didn't make an appointment, can you help me? Is that also an option?
We discourage drop-ins just in case there is an appointment, but in the event of an emergency or a sense of immediacy, then yes, absolutely.
Fantastic. Thank you.
I would recommend if they aren't set up with any providers yet to start with the SAP program, because the SAP program can then screen and really work together with the team to figure out what each staff person is seeing and come up with the best referral, whether you know it's an internal referral or for outside services, that's perfectly fine too. And the school-based mental health services do have to go through the SAP program anyhow, so if that were to be an option, it would have to go through the SAP screening program.
And how does a parent go about getting their student through the SAP referral process?
Yeah, there's a link right on the website, and they just can submit an online form.
On the Bethel Park website?
Bethel Park
Yeah, on the Bethel Park website, you go into the high school or IMS under the counseling tab, and then there's a student assistance program link. And there's lots of information about the program on that page too.
Some other ways would be 211. The United Way has a 211 helpline, and you can access behavioral health supports and services through 211. They can give a list of different agencies to provide the particular type of service that you're looking for. Also, many local providers have administrative service coordinators who families can call up, and the administrative service coordinators will link the family to whatever behavioral health supports and resources.
Just to build off of that, if you feel like you're stuck, or if a parent feels like they're stuck, just call somebody, and they will point you in the right direction. If that service that you call can't help, most services will start pointing you in the right direction. We take calls at my office all the time for other programs, and I always point them at least in the right direction. I'll take 3 minutes, I'll look something up on the computer, I'll ask them where they live, and I will point them in the right direction. And I don't think that there's anybody out there that works in the human service field that wouldn't do the same. So you have to ask. And, you know, it's one of those, you don't know what you don't know, so you have to start somewhere. So that would be that point of advice. I think for our program, ask your teacher and they'll get you a referral. It's, for our program, it's really that simple. If you have a good working relationship with your teacher, even if you don't have a good working relationship with the teacher, and you say, hey, I know I haven't talked to you before, but my son is struggling, I'm sure the teacher will put you in contact. You can say, I heard about the EPIC program, and they will get you in. So.
And just to reiterate, I'd like to go through again what mental health and behavioral resources are available through Bethel Park School District. We kind of hit on this a little bit in the last one, but if we can reiterate that, and if you want to start with our school psychologist to kind of see where the process starts.
Social workers. I'm primarily based at the elementary level, so we have school-based social workers for each of the elementary schools that work there multiple days in the week. And they, you know, it can be a parent referral, it could be a teacher referral. I mean, obviously they do need parent consent to do it, but, and they do a great job in each of the elementary schools doing either individual meetings with the students, or sometimes they do group, if they need to work on specific skills that would work better within a group, they'll do that. So that service is definitely readily available in each of our schools.
And if you've pursued all these options and meet with a school social worker and have an outside therapist, and the student is still struggling, you can reach out to Crystal and I for an evaluation. And we can help to determine what added supports we can provide the student through an individualized education plan. You know, if their behaviors are at the level that it's affecting their everyday performance in school, and what can we do as a team to support the student.
Does anybody else have any input they would like to add to that? At this point, we're going to open up the questions to our audience. If you have any additional questions for our panel, or anything else you would like further clarification about. I'm sorry. You just came to listen.
Oh, thank you. I won't give it back now. I just want to clarify and make sure I don't misunderstand. So the social workers in the elementary school are part of the EPIC program. That's the same thing, or is this two different sets of things?
Yes.
Same thing. Okay. That's what I thought, and then I was thinking, is there another thing going on?
No.
Okay. And the student assistance program isn't currently available for sixth grade and lower. That's really more EPIC is handling that?
Hot off the press.
We are right now expanding to Neil Armstrong for student assistance program and liaison services through Auberle. And we thank Allegheny County, too, that we had a addition to the funding through Auberle, that they're now using at Neil Armstrong. And then our next planning step would be to expand to school-based mental health at that level, which is grades 5 and 6. And our bigger plan, we have elementary administrators and staff trained in SAP. So the longer term plan will be then to expand services down. But right now our goal this year is Neil Armstrong 5-6. And we thank everybody. It's been a process to get that all underway. Mr. Dr. O'Rourke and I have been working with that for a very long time, and we've had a lot of great help with all of our partners and Dr. Hsu. So thanks.
I would also add that Epic is in all of the schools, I believe, a few days a week. So it just depends on what days the staff are there. All of our staff are full time, so they're here 5 days a week, but it just depends on what school. So.
Wonderful. I'm so excited. Yay. Thank you all. And thank you. And is it the SAP? I think you had mentioned that it was the SAP team that decides what, in consultation with everybody, and then refers, and it really should all be going through SAP, at least right now, IMS in high school levels.
Our SAP liaison would do mental health screening. She has a tool that she uses to kind of help narrow down what are the presenting symptoms and the presenting problems, and then the team works together to kind of figure out what is the best referral at that point, what is going to be the most helpful. And sometimes it is trial and error, and sometimes services don't work out, but that's why there's so many different options, and you know, hopefully it's something, some intervention that can help improve the student situation.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I also had a question. Since you mentioned about the IEPs, if the student already has an IEP, should the parent call an IEP team meeting to start some? Is that something that happens within the IEP or as opposed to a separate SAP? That's what I thought. And thank you for talking about trauma. And I loved what you said about just assume everybody has some kind of trauma you don't know about. And I think the different experiences of trauma, there are things that can happen that one person might perceive as a trauma that another person doesn't. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of times you might not know that the student has experienced trauma, particularly if the family isn't sharing that with you. And sometimes there might be a reason they're not, or it might not have occurred to them. And we have so many families in our district that grandparents are raising grandchildren. And there's issues. That's a trauma of some kind at some level for whatever reason. And I think trauma-informed care is really, really, really important. And trauma in schools and anxiety in schools can look a lot like a lot of other things, too. Aggression and anger and crying, and so thank you very much for all the information.
We really appreciate everybody coming out. We're also doing some ongoing professional development with our staff, with our professional staff and our paraprofessional staff. On November 4th and 5th, we were able to have some of our partners here present. Auberle presented. We had outreach, Dr. Tracy Scanlon from outreach presented, Amanda Roberts and Ashley presented from Auberle. We had the Allegheny Intermediate Unit did a session on trauma-informed care, so this is something ongoing. And tonight is just the beginning so that you can see who our interagency partners are that we really enjoy working with and continuing to develop a very collaborative relationship. So more resources will be put on the website so that you can check those out. We have now some brochures with outreach, and Rusty Hewitt brought a lot of information. We'll try to link some of those on the website as well. So do reach out. And then to conclude our evening, Dr. O'Rourke's going to share another wonderful opportunity that's in the works for the whole Bethel Park community, right?
Good evening, everyone. I was behind the camera, so if anybody has any complaints about the camera work being done, it was on me this evening. As Ms. Sutton had said, my name is Janet O'Rourke. I'm the assistant to the superintendent here in Bethel Park, and this has been such a work in progress, and I'm sitting back there and feel such gratitude to our team of people that are involved right now with mental health in our school district as our society struggles with finding balance and being able to be supportive, compassionate, and caring to one another. It is something for us to have the resources available for our children on a regular basis and our families. And I think what one takeaway that I heard, and don't get bogged down by process. If you need support, if your child needs support, just reach out and call. You are always welcome to call, email me. I will get back in touch with you. But I think it's so important to make sure that we offer that support to our children and our families within our district. And on that note, Bethel Park School District and the municipality of Bethel Park are partnering together to do a Bethel Park Health Wellness Summit in February. And one of the strands that we're going to be offering during that time will be mental health, and we'll have keynote speakers the week of February 23rd to the 28th. It'll be held at the community center. There will be speakers available. There will be information sessions, screenings, things out on tables for people to get information and hopefully provide support in the areas of mental health, nutrition, and stress reduction, because those are definitely areas that we could all benefit from. So I hope to see a lot of people there, and if anybody is interested in being involved in any way, don't hesitate to reach out to me. I'd be more than happy to talk to you about what we're doing and our plan and see where we can fit you in. The more the merrier, and the support is definitely appreciated for our community in Bethel Park and our Bethel Park family. And finally, I just want to say thank you sincerely and without hesitation to be here, to offer the support that you offer our children, and to make such a positive impact and such a wonderful team to work with. And that's just so nice for me to see as we work with the 4,000 plus students and families in the Bethel Park School District, but then also having the opportunity with BPTV offering to tape this today, hopefully reaching out to the community at large. And that's really a resource that the school district wants to do, and we're very proud to provide that for you this evening. Thank you once again for everything, and I think that concludes our session for this evening. Stay tuned. We may have additional family nights, and we'll be excited to share those with you.